safest places. Broken souls with smiling faces, fighting for surrender, for now and the after, yeah. Just look around and you see that people are scared to say how they really feel. Oh, we all need a little honesty.
Good morning to everyone.
Morning, Ms. Tommy.
Hope I've already spoken to everyone. This morning I'd like to talk about sort of the old and the new. Still a good question. And for those of us who went through this Bible study, I know you've probably already heard this or read this story, but I thought it was a unique story, and I'd like to share it with you. Over 100 years ago, Charles Shelton wrote a book called In His Steps. It begins in a sleepy little church where a man, down on his luck, goes to worship one morning. At the end of the service, he walks down to the front to explain to the congregation how he had sought their help but couldn't find any. He wasn't being mean, just stating his experience. Suddenly he collapsed and was taken to the hospital where he died. The pastor, being shaken by the whole episode, preached about it the next Sunday. He challenged his congregation for a whole year to live with the words, "What would Jesus do?" This is where that expression comes from, a book written in 1897. Now, a lot of us younger people and older people too think that's something that we created, the WWJD. Is that correct? But we didn't. You see, that's the past. We picked up on that. So we should realize how important the past is in governing our future. Today, that phrase has been branded about quite a bit. You even see it on bracelets and jewelry. It has become almost too familiar to us, yet following Christ all still comes down to that. It means being willing to live with a simple question: what would Jesus do in my shoes? What does it mean to live the way Jesus did in everyday life? So this is what I want to express to you now, is the way. Every morning when you wake up, as soon as your feet hit the floor, say this prayer: Jesus, what would you have me to do today? The Reformation leader, Martin Luther, said, we are to be little Christ. That is what true believing looks like, letting Christ live through us. According to the book of Acts 9:2, it said that Saul, in his persecution of the Jews, wanted a list of letters against those who were of the way, so he could persecute them. In Psalms 37:5, it says, commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will do as he says. In Exodus 33, if you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so I may find favor with you. And then in Ephesians 4, it tells us how to be in the way. Be completely humble and gentle, be patient, hearing one with one another in love. That's how we recognize the way, when we spot someone who displays those. That's a telling statement. Did it mean that people noticed that this community lived as Jesus did, following his way of life? Following the way means living the way of Jesus. People living like Jesus is what's drawn others to the Christian faith. As you seek to follow the way of Jesus, I'll invite you to try a simple exercise this week. Every morning when you wake up, stop and ask Jesus, what would you have me to do for you today? Amen. Oh, the announcements are few and far between this week, so I guess we're going to take a week of rest before the Mother's Day season. Someone left a card here from Bonnie and Leo, and it says, thank you, dear Ebenezer Church family. We sincerely thank you for all that you did for Daddy's funeral, from setup to feeding the family and all the things in between, especially for the prayers, the Jack McCollum family. If you'd like to read that, it'll be posted on the bulletin board for a week or so. The youth trip to the Passion Play is this coming next weekend, so the church is going to be few. So you know what the ones that are left has to do. Get out and drag some people in. The men's breakfast will be Saturday, May the 6th. You know, the little kids don't go to the breakfast, so life goes on. And remember that May the 14th is Mother's Day. And how lucky you are if you still have your mother. And how blessed that you have wonderful memories. The preacher and his wife will be gone on vacation Sunday, May the 21st. Colin Mills, the youth director at Hickory Flat, will be our guest preacher. Do we have any prayer concerns this morning?
We have one more announcement. We will have Bible study tonight at 5 o'clock and choir practice that following. That's not in there, but Bible study at 5 o'clock tonight, choir.
Bible study will be at 5 o'clock and choir practice at 6. We invite you to come. We don't bite. Sometimes we have to try to control the preacher, but...
You do.
And Peter Gracian, I am very, very busy. Yes, as I.
Any other prayer concerns?
Yes, do pray for our teachers and students as they finish up the school year, doing all this state testing and everything. It's very stressful.
I have an unsaid, and then I would also like to add Sammy Jo Poole and Journey and Chance. She's the mother of our little twins, Ricky, Journey and Chance. They really need some prayers.
Chance. Is it Chance? Sure, they'll need an address. Please remember that when you do request a prayer for someone, that Miss Betty will need an address. Anyone we can take off? We have birthdays this week. Bryson Martin, Corey McCollum, and Alicia Rogue.
Okay.
And which they're not here this morning. So if we see them out and about, or just add them to your prayers on those particular days. Is there anything else? Barbara, would you lead us in prayer?
This time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. Father, we believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back. He's coming.
Tears, and everyone stand. We're getting our exercise this morning.
Yeah. God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose again. He ascended into heaven, and he sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Greet your neighbor. Everyone open your book, hymnal to page 86, Going Home.
Receive our gifts now, and each and every one of us who give. Bless all to the good of your kingdom, we pray it in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
who have completed 100 points in ARS reading this year. We have got a lot to be proud of in our young people. Today I wanted to talk about different things we find in our toolbox. Hey, what is that?
A saw.
You need a saw if we're going to chop down a tree. Don't we saw down a tree or do something like that? You can find something for that. And what about this? A hammer. Man, that'll get them nails in there just in a few minutes, won't it? What about this?
A screwdriver.
Let's get them screws in whenever we're building, right? Right. What about this? Or what this is?
A fire.
To help you hold things if you need to or if you can cook up. What is this?
A tape.
Got to have that to know how big we're going to build something. These are all tools, aren't they? And they all have a different job to do, but they all go into building something, don't they? Just like y'all. Y'all are all different, but God has a plan for each one of you to do for His world. Did you know that? Now we're talking about your job you're going to do for the Lord, hey? Lord has something for you to do. He's made us all different, so we'll meet those needs that He has for us. And just like we need all these tools to build, God needs all of you to build for His church. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, be with our young people. Help them to continue to grow and to show your love to everyone they meet. Amen. Good job. Okay, you guys, you know what to do with tools, don't you? Y'all want to choose one? You might want to choose two.
attention up here to the scripture for Hebrews. And if you want to turn in your Bible, you can too, but I want us to all read it together. You can stay seated, but I want us to all read from Hebrews chapter 3. Starting in, I believe, verse 7. Verse 7, turn there. You can leave your Bible open, but look up here and let us all read this together. That seventh verse, like this. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, as on the day of testing in the wilderness. Stop there. Stop right there. Today, if you hear what?
His voice.
Do not what? Do not harden your hearts. Question, is there a voice that speaks to us that we cannot hear with our ears and yet is still speaking to us?
Yes.
The answer is yes. And so when you hear the voice of the one who speaks to us, do not harden your heart. How do you harden your heart? You refuse. To harden your heart is like the little boy that was standing up in church and they kept telling him to sit down. And he'd stand up and they say, sit down. And he'd stand up and they say, sit down. He finally sat down, but he said, I am sitting down on the outside, but I am standing up on the inside. That is what it means to refuse the voice of one that is speaking. When you're in church and the Holy Spirit says it's time to come get some things straight and you don't come and get some things straight, what are you doing? Are you responding to the Holy Spirit or are you hardening your heart? We're going to read the rest of it. We're going to read it together, but I'm going to hit this thing and hit it a good whack like I had a hammer in my hand. If the Holy Spirit says you need to start treating your wife better and you don't treat your wife better, are you doing what the Holy Spirit says or are you hardening your heart? If the Holy Spirit says, I need to start inviting some people to church, and you don't invite some people to church, are you responding or are you hardening?
Hardening.
All right. So if you hear the voice, and so the voice is being heard. For those that have ears to hear, Jesus said, those that have ears to hear, let them hear. I listen to the things I want to hear. I don't know about you, but if I want to hear it, I'm going to listen to it. And if I don't have any interest in it, I ain't gonna listen. I'm not gonna listen to it. Someone got on me for saying ain't the other day, so I probably ain't gonna say it today. But I listen to what I want to hear. But if I don't want to hear it, I'll go like this or whatever. Maybe not like this, but I said, no, I'm not listening. If you want to hear what it is that God has to say to you, you're going to hear what God has to say to you. If you are only interested in hearing what you want to hear, chances are you may not hear quite as clearly. So today, if you hear His voice, today, not tomorrow, today. Today, if you hear His voice, not tomorrow, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts. Verse 9, is that up there? Come on. Where your ancestors put me to the test, though they had seen my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation, and I said, they always go astray in their hearts, and they have not known my ways. As in my anger, I swore, they will not enter my rest. Stop there. They will not enter my what?
Rest.
They will not enter my what?
Rest.
How many of you know that God wants you to have rest and peace and contentment on the inside? How many of you know that? If you know that, raise your hand and maybe even say amen.
Amen.
How many of you know that God does not want your life full of confusion and despair and darkness every single day? On Hee Haw, they used to sing, gloom, despair, and agony on me, deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. How y'all remember that? The Holy Spirit does not want your life full of gloom, despair, and agony every single day. And if every single day of my life is filled with nothing but darkness and despair, come see me, not because I'm a hotshot, but because I like to help people. Go see Miss Leslie. Go see somebody. Go see a friend. Go see a trusted family member. Go see somebody and say, what in the world is going on with me? Sitting in a church is nice. To have the spirit that brought the church into existence is a whole lot better.
It is nice to sit in church. It is much nicer to have the Holy Spirit sitting and living and breathing and moving in your heart. God wants you to have and wants me to have peace in our hearts. So, but he says what? You wouldn't enter in. You wouldn't enter in. Verse 12, let's read it together. Take care, brothers and sisters, that none of you may have an evil and unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. Stop there. An unbelieving heart. An evil and unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. So if you want to know the essence of what it means to be an evil person, you just got it right there. Chapter and verse. Hebrews 3, verse 12. An evil person is a person that what? That turns away from God. A person that is quote unquote good is a person that turns in the direction of God. If I turn away from God, the chances are I'm not going to do what it is that God wants me to do. But if I consistently turn in the direction of God, do not turn away from the living God. Verse 13, let's keep on reading. But exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. If you like to underline in your Bible or circle in your Bible, you might circle that word none. Now, I had to go to several years of seminary to learn that in the original language, that none means none. And none means not one. Everybody here, everybody that didn't come, everybody. God sees everybody. Everybody is the way they tell me to say that word. Everybody. Everybody. God wants everybody, not just a couple of people. God wants what? Everybody. He wants you and you, everybody. That none may what? That none may fall. Everybody. God cares the same about you as he does about Billy Graham. He loves you in exactly the same way that he loves the Pope, and he loves Billy Graham, and he loved President Reagan, and whoever else. I don't know why I just said Reagan. Someone's missing Reagan right about now. Oh, okay, whatever. He loved everybody the same way. Even Stephen, someone said. Even Stephen. It's all even. That none may what? That none may fall of the grace of God. That none. God doesn't want anybody to fall. He doesn't want you to fall. He doesn't want me to fall. If you do fall, you know what you need to do? You need to pick yourself up and dust yourself off and start all over again. You know what the real problem is when we won't stand up anymore, when we won't get up, when we won't keep going. And sometimes it's a challenge just to keep going, by the way. Sometimes all you can do with the day is say, God, give me the strength that I need to do, that I need to keep going today. In fact, say that with me. Lord, keep me going today. Some of us pray that, and we pray it through the skin of our teeth because we say, I don't know if I've got what I need to do what I need to do today. If you fall, though, if you fall when you're going, don't feel, look at it, if you don't make a mistake, you're not trying. The only people that do anything at all are the people that mess up every once in a while. Don't worry about falling. Now, you need to take falling seriously, and if you keep falling in the same way time after time after time after time, it may need be time to get a little bit of help. If I keep falling in the same way every single time, and I told someone the way I used to fall all the time, and something needs to change. See, it needs to change where? In me. If I keep falling on the same thing every single time, it's not the world out there that needs to change, and I'm waiting for the world out there to change. I'm going to be waiting a whole long time. If you're sitting in this church this morning and you keep waiting for the world to change, you're going to be waiting a whole lot of Sundays and Mondays and every other day of the week. That none may what? That none may fall. I lost my verse because we're having fun here. What? That none may fall. That none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. See, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Let's keep reading. Verse 14. For we have become partners of Christ, if only we hold our first confidence firm to the end. Stop there. My wife has a song that she loves that's called I Shall Not Be Moved. And I got here and I said, I can't stand that song. And she said, too bad, we're singing it anyway. She loves it. I can't stand it. I'll tell you why I don't like it. Because I know people that sit in church and they say, I'm not going to be moved by the song, by the sermon, by the Spirit of the living God. I'm not going to be moved by anything. That's the reason I don't like that song. I don't think that's what it means. You know what that song means? I'm going to keep on keeping on. I shall not be moved doesn't mean that you don't keep moving forward. It means what? I'm not going to move backwards. You only got two ways that you can go, either go forward or go backwards. There's no standing still in life. There really isn't. You may think you're standing still, but you're either going forward or you're going backward. You're either going up higher or you're going down lower.
Amen.
You're either going up higher the mountain or whatever. I won't push the image, but you got it right. What was it that I just read? Only hold firm our confidence to the end. I shall not be moved. I'm going to keep going. And if you need someone to hold your hand, let somebody hold your hand. And if you're worried about a guy holding your hand and you're a guy, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about what other people think. I'll hug guys every once in a while simply because I need a hug.
Yes.
I bet you Jesus hugged the disciples sometimes.
Yes.
Huh? Don't worry about what other people think. Verse 15, let's read it. As it is said today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. Now y'all stop there. He said it not once, but what?
Twice.
If he said it twice, you think it's pretty important? Do not harden. If you hear his voice today, someone saying, come and get something right. Come and start changing some things. Come and start doing a new thing. If you hear his voice today, do not harden your hearts. Verse 16, we'll finish it out now. Now, who were they who heard and yet were rebellious? Was it not all those who left Egypt under the leadership of Moses? But with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, if not to those who were disobedient? So we see that they were not able to enter in because of unbelief. We had an interesting discussion the other day about things that make people angry. A couple of us talking about things that make people angry. And had any number of things that make people angry. She said, my husband gets angry when he has not had enough food. He gets hangry. Now, you know someone, you are not someone like that, but you know someone in your life that gets hangry. When they have not had enough to eat, they don't just get hungry, they get hangry. And I need some food because I'm angry because I hadn't eaten. Now, if you hadn't eaten for several days, unless you fasted, everybody's probably going to get a little bit ill. But she said, my husband gets angry when I don't have enough to eat. She said, I tend to get angry when I don't get enough sleep. If I have been going and I have been going and I have been going, I get angry when I don't get enough sleep. You say, oh me, both of those make me angry. I don't know what I'm going to do. Well, don't worry about it. And I got to wondering about what makes me angry. My friend, Dr. Phil McGraw, better known as Dr. Phil, who I am convinced is full of the wisdom of the ages. I don't care what you say. I like listening to Dr. Phil because he makes good sense. Dr. Phil said, anger comes from one of three places. It either comes from fear, frustration, or hurt. So if you are one of these people that likes to understand why it is that you feel the way you do and why it is that you sometimes respond to in feeling the way you do, there you go right there. I think that's good sense. Fear, hurt, or frustration. But I started to try to wonder, Janice, what it is that makes me so angry. And I said, I know exactly what makes me angry. When someone gets in my way, traffic jams, lines in the grocery store, someone walking about 2 miles an hour right in front of me and there's no place to go. When someone gets in my way, you know why I think I probably get angry about that is because I wasted so much time in my life. I spent so many years wasting time, wasting the opportunities that I had. Biblically speaking, the wilderness is the desert between Egypt and what we call now Israel, the Holy Land. That is the wilderness. Historically, biblically speaking, it is the place, it is the space, it is the desert between leaving the land of slavery, which is Egypt, not because the Egyptians are worse than anybody else, but it's an image we use to make a point. That's it. Don't say the preacher said the Egyptians are worse sinners than anybody. No, that's not true. We got wonderful believing people all over the world, red, yellow, black, and white. They are precious in his sight. That's what Jesus told me, and I believe it. It's not a Bible verse, but I still believe it. All colors, all creeds, all backgrounds. Egypt is the land of slavery. Israel, Canaan, whatever language you want to use, is the land of promise. And the desert between those two points. They tell me that to get from Egypt to get to Israel on foot ought to take about 2 weeks' time. About 2 weeks' time. From where they were to where they wanted to go took about 2 weeks' time. Do you know how long they spent in the wilderness according to the Bible? 40 years they spent in the wilderness. going from here to going there. I know what you're asking right now. You're asking, what is the promised land? Is it heaven? No, it's not heaven. It is not heaven. Because when they got to the promised land, they still had challenges. Now, I'm of the opinion that when we get to heaven, we still won't have things to do. You may be looking forward to having your hammock in heaven, and you got your pina colada, and you not, that's fine. If that's your little slice of heaven, that's fine. You can do that. I happen to think we still gonna have things to do, kind of like in Star Trek, where no man has gone before. I think I'm still gonna have places to go and people to see and things to do. That's my conviction. But if we got challenges with sin and death and the devil in heaven, I don't think so. I don't think the promised land is heaven. I think the promised land is where it is that we need to get to. Those blessings we need to get to, those promises we need to get to, those gifts that we need to get to. And the wilderness is what? The wilderness is the process of getting from point A to point B. Now, you may be one among these people that gets everything that you want in exactly the time that you want it, in exactly the way you want it. But I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, and I'm going to get up here because I'm talking a little bit loud and I don't want to scare anybody. I'm here to tell you that most of us that are slogging through this life do not get most of what it is that we want exactly the way that we want it, in exactly the time we want it. It takes time to get what it is that where it is that you need to get to. Especially when it's stuff that matters, stuff like relationships take time. You can fall in love in a second, but love takes an entire lifetime. You can feel like you love the guy. Oh, I love his eyes, and I love the way he does that thing with his lips, and I love the way he walks, but just hang on for a couple weeks, and you're going to say, if he uses that tone of voice with me one time, I'm going to slap him silly. Love takes time. It takes a lifetime to love somebody. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. When God puts it in your heart and you go after it with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind, it will bring you joy. Takes an entire lifetime to what? To work a gift. I was watching Hayden here a couple of minutes ago with his hammers and with his screwdrivers and with his saws, and he's got a gift. You know how I knew? Because he jumped on it. He knew everything, and he probably knows a dozen. He probably, he does know more than I do. I'm 50 years old. How are you now, son? 3-4 years old, and he already knows more. Why? Because four, and he's got a gift. But it takes time. It's not enough to have a gift or a talent. It takes time to use that talent and to develop that talent. The things that matter, everything that matters in this life takes time. And the wilderness is process. And it's also a symbol of wasting time. Of wasting time with things that don't matter. That aren't going to amount to a hill of brains. You can waste time in any number of ways. You can just say, well, I'm just going to do whatever I want to with whoever I want to. I'm trying not to use ugly language here, but if you're sitting here and you're thinking I can do whatever it is that I want to do and the way I want to do it, and God's still going to bless it, I got news for you. It ain't going to happen. Amen. Do I have to be plainer? Because, I know y'all got things to do and I know y'all got people to see, but do I need to say that again? If you are saying that I can do whatever it is that I want with whomever it is I want to do it, and God is still going to bless me, I got news for you. It's not going to happen. You can get to heaven, I'm convinced, by the skin of your teeth, but if you want the blessing of God in your life, you're going to have to work the blessing. But there are any number of things that will keep you in the wilderness, grumbling and murmuring all your days. You say, I don't know about grumbling and murmuring. I'll tell you right now, and I'm going to get close to the mic so you can hear what it sounds like. It sounds like this. How you doing today? What do you think about your boyfriend? You having a good day today? 1 week later, you having a good day? Grumbling. Now, you need to take your complaints to Almighty God. I do it every day. And if you haven't learned the great and glorious pleasure of being able to complain to God, then you've got a ways to go yet, because you can take anything you want and you can say it any way you want to. There is psalm after psalm that says, take your complaints to God. But grumbling and complaining, spending the days of your life, well, it rains too much, or it doesn't rain enough, or it's too hot, or it's too... You're not going to get out of the wilderness then. Unforgiveness. Forget it. I wouldn't say unforgiveness. Grudges. There, that. Oh. Grudges. Just holding on to stuff. You just want grudges. Mentally, spiritually, personally, you can't go anywhere. Why? Because Mr. William Faulkner was right. The past is never past, and it's not dead. But you can allow the past to move you forward. And if you're going to do nothing more than hold grudges against people that said something about that blue dress that you wore to prom 30, honey, go ahead and get over it. It's a waste of time. Or just meandering. This is my testimony. This is my sad testimony. And it makes me so angry I can't sit still. Just meandering. You know what meandering means? I'm going to show you what meandering. Oh, I'm going to go here. No, I'm going to go. No, no, I won't go. No, meandering. I want to walk up. I want. No, I'm going to go over here. No, here, I'm meandering. I'm not getting anywhere. I'm not getting anywhere. You got to make lateral movements sometimes, but I'm not getting anywhere. Because what? I'm meandering. My brother's name is Leander. We talk about meandering with Leander. He doesn't meander. He is straight as an arrow, man. You're wasting time. Wasting the time of your life. The days of your life, you say, wait until heaven. I am convinced that there are people that will get to heaven, and when they get there, they will say, is this all there is? I really am. If you can't be happy with the blood of Jesus cleansing you from sins and the Holy Spirit filling you with joy and peace, which is what the Holy Spirit wants to do, and the gifts that God gives, if you can't find some joy and some happiness in some measure in this life, what makes you think you're going to be happy when you got the fullness of it? Yeah, and all of God's people said amen. Yeah. So what's my point? My point is you got to go in. You got. Let me just say it. I heard a speaker today, and I'm almost done. No, I'm not. I'll go about 10, 15 more minutes. You know, just hang on. A speaker said, I run into workers, teenage workers and young workers all the time with gifts, with intelligence, with abilities, and I ask them how it is that it's going, and they say, I think I'm about to quit because I'm not making an impact. They said, you've been there 5 months. How are you going to make an impact in 5 months? I heard it this morning, getting ready to preach this thing, and I ran into it on Facebook. That's the Holy Spirit just putting something in your mug. It takes time to get to where it is that you're going. It's a long way to, I don't know, what's that song? It's a long way to temple, where it is. It takes a while. It's a long way to the top if you want to rock and roll. No, that ain't right. It takes time. But you want to go on in. You know how you do it? You do it right here in your head. So oftentimes it happens, we live our lives in chains and we never even know that we had the key. That is a good line. It's from the Eagles too. For those of you wondering what hymn book I got out of it, I got it out of the Don Henley hymn book. So, hello Jesus. So oftentimes it happens, we live our lives in chains and we never even know we have the key. And then he says, I'm already gone. Wasted time, wasted years, wasted time in the wilderness. You say, I've been born again. Let me tell you something about being born again. New birth, the new life, whatever language you want to use, that we get tripped up on language and saying they don't talk the way. They say Holy Spirit, not Holy Ghost. I'm never going. Churches break up because they don't say Holy Spirit. They don't even say Holy Ghost. They say Holy Spirit. And I said, I'm going to Holy Ghost Church. What is that all about? Let me tell you something about the new birth. The new birth is a start, but it's not the end. It is a start, but it is not the ending. The ending is out there. What promises? What gifts, what blessings, what desires, what things in your heart and in your life that you want to go after? Say, I want to graduate. Is say, I want to graduate and I want to get married and I want to have a family. If that is the goal of your whole life, God bless you. That's fine. If your goal is to graduate from high school, get a husband, and get a house, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. That is a noble, that is a wonderful thing. But there are people here that have got things in their heart and they don't even know what to do with them. I can tell you what you need to do. You need to stop wasting time in the wilderness and you just need to start moving forward with the things, with the gifts, with the promises that God has put in your heart. Today, if you hear, if you hear his voice today, I can't remember my story. I had a story for you, Ray. No, it wasn't. I didn't even know he was coming today. I had a story for you, and I don't even know how to close it, except to just tell you what I just told you again from Henley. I love it so much, I'm going to say it a third time. So oftentimes, we live our lives in chains, and we don't even know we have the key. Key's inside. Inside. Disciples asked Jesus one time, he said, the kingdom of God is not here, it's not there. The kingdom of God is within you, is among you. Among you. You don't want to waste time rooting around, grubbing around. Pardon me, sleeping around. Grumbling around. Meandering around in the wilderness. You don't need to. You don't need to spend a lifetime wasting time. You need to go on in. In him, yes and amen. The promises of God are yea and amen for everyone that will what? I'm already thinking about Christmas presents. Here's my end. Christmas presents. What good is a Christmas present if you won't open it? Amen. Let's pray. That was Jesus. To keep on moving. The movement comes from the Spirit. The will to move comes from ourselves. The gift comes from God. The putting into use the gift is our business. Salvation is your gift, God. What we do with it is our business. Help us to do the very best with everything that you give us, and we'll give you praise for it. Amen. Here's my story. I got it. Lynn Cook, who's not here this morning, but she put a thing on Facebook. Here's what she said. Here's what it said on Facebook. She said, God does not give you a good life or a bad life. He gives you a life. We make it good or we make it bad. Do you believe that?
Yes.
100%. 100%. Not a good or bad life. God gives us a life. What we do with it, we make it. Under the inspiration of the Spirit. Miss Sarah, you want to come? What are we all saying?
Jesus is calling.
Jesus is calling.
Oh,
one other little thing to just to say, to put a footnote there about hearing the voice of God. There's the voice of a preacher speaking, a teacher speaking, whatever. There's the voices that you hear, and then there's the stuff on the inside that you know, that you know, that you know. That's the voice. It's the stuff that you really know, and the stuff that you're convinced of. Just FYI, someone leaves here, I say, I don't know about the voice of God. I just gave it to you right there in a nutshell. It's the stuff on the inside that really is going to move you forward. So may God move each and every one of us forward. In the name of Jesus, by the love of God, in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
To be superheroes, photoshopped, all size zeros, a light not expected, but not quite perfected yet.